All right, good morning. Hey guys, happy amazing July 4th, 2020, COVID style. COVID-19, yeah, I know a lot of the beaches have been closed. A lot of all the normal fun stuff we like to do here on July 4th, it's kind of not happening. A lot of people are just hanging out in their homes, having people over. I'm keeping it pretty low key. So just want to say God bless you. Hope you guys have an amazing day today. So as many of you may or may not know, I'm actually working through the book called I Do Not Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. A really great book, and I'm doing a chapter by chapter video summary on my first time ever reading the book, and I wanted to do a chapter by chapter walkthrough with you, and it's really good information. I thought it was kind of interesting. So anyways, my last video was actually about the introduction. Now this video summary is going to be about chapter one. So in this video, we're gonna look at, or rather the author's overview. Number one, what is truth? Number two, are statements like, what's true for you is not for me. All truth is relative. Do those even follow their own logic? Number three, can all religions be true? And then lastly, truth versus tolerance. Has our culture changed the definition of tolerance that actually doesn't meet its own standard, right? So let's jump straight into this. Men stumble over truth from time to time, but most pick themselves up and hurry off as if nothing happened. Winston Churchill. So the authors of the book actually open up with talking about the movie A Few Good Men and the scene where Jack Nicholson yells at Tom Cruise and says, "You can't handle the truth," right? We've all heard that phrase many times. So the author states, on one hand, we demand truth in virtually every area of our lives. For example, we demand truth from loved ones. No one wants lies from a spouse or a child. Number two, doctors. We want the right medicines prescribed and the right operations performed. Number three, stockbrokers. We demand that they tell us the truth about companies they recommend. Number four, courts. We want them to convict only the truly guilty. Number five, employers. We want them to tell us the truth and pay us fairly. Airlines. We demand truly safe planes and truly sober pilots. And then number seven, we demand truth in reference books. We demand truth from teachers, and we demand truth from road signs, right? So we demand truth in almost every facet about our money, relationships, safety, or health, right? On the other hand, despite our unwavering demands for truth in those areas, many of us say we're not interested in truth when it comes to morality or religion. In fact, many downright reject the idea that any religion can be true. So I love how the author really opens up here, because it's so true, right? We all demand truth in basically every area of our life, right? We don't want the doctor to lie to us if there's a condition that we have. We want to know the truth. We don't want your spouse or a significant other to lie to you. It's all truth, right? We all demand the truth, right? So really great point. So the author goes on to say that, I'm sure you've noticed there's a huge contradiction here. Why do we demand truth in everything but morality and religion? Why do we say that's true for you but not for me when we're talking about morality or religion, but we would never think of such nonsense when we're talking to a stockbroker about our money or a doctor about our health, right? And can you imagine that? Can you imagine that your doctor says, okay, great, you have this condition, here's the cure, I'm gonna prescribe you a note to go down to Walgreens and pick it up, but then you're like, doc, that's true for you, but not for me. I like you, but I'm good. We would never do that, right? Or let's say that you have a stockbroker that says, sir or miss, we are actually recommending to remove your funds out of Widget Z company because they're about to go bankrupt. They just filed bankruptcy this morning and their shares are $100 a share and they are about to go down to one penny a share. But then you're like, you know what, that's true for you, but not for me. Put $20,000 more into Widget Z Company, right? We would never do that. So anyways, moving on, the next point is that the authors go in to talk about what is truth, right? What is truth? So he says truth can be defined by telling it like it is, or truth, or that which corresponds to its object, or that which describes an actual state of affairs. So contrary to what is being taught in many public schools, truth is not relative, but absolute. If something is true, it's true for all people at all times in all places. All truth claims are absolute, narrow, and exclusive. Just think about the claim, everything is true. That's an absolute, narrow, and exclusive claim. It excludes its opposite. Let me say that again. It excludes its opposite. It claims the statement, everything is not true, is wrong. In fact, all truths exclude their opposite, even religious truths. So the author goes on to share that other truths about truth, which are, number one, truth is discovered, not invented. It exists independent of anyone's knowledge. Gravity existed prior to Newton. Truth is transcultural. If something is true, it is true for all people in all places at all times. 2 + 2 = 4 for everyone, everywhere, at every time. Truth is unchanging, even though our beliefs about truth change. When we begin to believe the earth was round instead of flat, the truth about the earth did not change, only our belief about earth changed. Beliefs cannot change a fact, no matter how sincerely they're held. Someone can sincerely believe the world is flat, but that only makes that person sincerely mistaken. Truth is not affected by the attitude of the one professing it. An arrogant person does not make the truth he professes false. A humble person does not make the error he professes true. All truths are absolute. Even truths that appear to be relative are really absolute. For example, I, Frank Turek, the author, feel warm on November 20th, 2003. That may appear to be a relative truth, but it is actually absolutely true for everyone everywhere that Frank had that sensation of warmth on that day. So in short, contrary beliefs are possible, but contrary truths are not possible. We can believe everything is true, but we cannot make everything true. So next, the author goes on to talk about self-defeating statements. So the author talks here that there is a radio show that he wanted to call into because the show host had someone call in that said, there's no such thing as truth. And then the author wanted to call in and say in response to that, is that true? So a self-defeating statement is one that fails to meet its own standard. The statement, there's no truth, is like saying, I can't speak a word of English. The author said, you know, no doubt we've all heard statements like, all truth is relative, and there are no absolutes. The way to know if it's a self-defeating statement is to ask the question back, for example, all truth is relative. Is that absolutely true? There are no absolutes. Are you absolutely sure? It's true for you, but not for me. Is that statement true just for you, or is it true for everyone? And that one may be the mantra of our day, but that's not really how the world works. Imagine saying that to your doctor or a stockbroker, like we talked about earlier. So the truth of the matter is this: false ideas about truth lead to false ideas about life. In many cases, these false ideas give apparent justification for what is really immoral behavior. For if you can kill the concept of truth, then you can kill the concept of any true religion or any true morality. So truth exists, it cannot be denied. Those who deny truth make the self-defeating truth claim that there is no truth. In this regard, they're a lot like Winnie the Pooh. They answer at the knock of the door by saying that no one is home. So next, the author goes in to talk about, can all religions be true? The author touches on several different things in this section, and I think these were the good points to note. So Christians believe that those who have not accepted Christ as their savior have chosen hell as their ultimate destination. It's often overlooked, but many Muslims believe the same about non-Muslims, that they're headed for hell as well. And Hindus generally believe that everyone, regardless of beliefs, is caught in an indefinite cycle of reincarnation based on works. And these contradictory beliefs cannot all be true. In fact, world religions have more contradictory beliefs than complementary ones. The notion that all religions teach basically the same thing, that we ought to love one another, demonstrates a serious misunderstanding of world religions. While most religions have some kind of similar moral code because God has implanted that on our conscience, and the authors are going to talk more about that in chapter 7. So again, while most religions have some kind of similar moral code because God has implanted right and wrong on our conscience, they disagree on virtually every major issue, including the nature of God, the nature of man, sin, salvation, hell, and creation. Those are major. So here are a few of those differences. Jews, Christians, and Muslims believe in a different version of a theistic God, while most Hindus and New Agers believe that everything that exists is part of an impersonal pantheistic force they call God. Many Hindus believe that evil is a complete illusion, while Christians, Muslims, and Jews believe that evil is real. Christians believe that people are saved by grace, while all other religions, if they believe in salvation at all teach some kind of salvation by good works, and the definition of good works and what one is saved from varies actually greatly. So these are just a few of the many essential differences. So much for the idea that all religions teach basically the same thing. That's false. So next, the author goes on to talk about truth versus tolerance, which I thought was actually super interesting. So it seems that our modern culture have changed the definition of tolerance. So the author goes in here to this point. While most religions have some beliefs that are true, not all religious beliefs can be true because they are mutually exclusive. They teach opposites. In other words, some religious beliefs must be wrong. But you're not supposed to say that in America today, right? You're supposed to be tolerant of all religious beliefs. And in our culture today, tolerance no longer means to put up with something you believe to be false. After all, you don't tolerate the things you agree with. Tolerance now means that you're supposed to accept every belief as true. In a religious context, this is also known as religious pluralism. The belief that all religions are true, there are a number of problems with this new definition of tolerance, and now the author goes on to talk a little bit about those. Before he gets into that, the author does say that they are thankful that we have religious freedoms in this country, and how they don't believe in imposing religion legislatively, and they're very aware of religious intolerance and believe that we should accept and respect others, people who have a different religious beliefs. But that doesn't mean that we personally ought to embrace the impossible notion that all religious beliefs are true. Since mutually exclusive religious beliefs cannot be true, it makes no sense to pretend that they are. In fact, it's dangerous to do so. If Christianity is true, then it's dangerous to your eternal destiny not to be a Christian. Likewise, if Islam is true, then it's dangerous to your eternal destiny not to be a Muslim. Second, the claim that you ought not to question someone's religious beliefs is itself a religious belief for pluralists. But this belief is just as exclusive and intolerant as any religious belief of a Christian or Muslim. In other words, pluralists think that all non-pluralist beliefs are wrong. So pluralists are just as dogmatic and closed-minded as anyone else making truth claims in the public square. And they want everyone who disagrees with them to see things their way. So another problem with the new definition of tolerance is the prohibition against questioning religious beliefs is also an absolute moral position. Why shouldn't we question religious beliefs? Would it be immoral to do so? And if so, by whose standard? Do pluralists have any good reasons supporting their belief that we ought not to question religious beliefs, or is it just their own personal opinion that they want to impose on the rest of us? And why are pluralists trying to impose that moral position on us anyways? That's not very tolerant of them, right? I thought that kind of was interesting. So lastly, the author says, the pluralist claim that we ought not to question religious beliefs is a derivative of false culture prohibition against making judgments. Their prohibition against judging is false because it fails to meet its own standard. You ought not judge is itself a judgment. Pluralists and many people alike misinterpret Jesus' command on judging in Matthew 7, verses 1 through 5. Jesus did not prohibit judging as such, only judging hypocritically. Indeed, everyone, including the pluralist, the Christian, the atheist, the agnostic, make judgments. So the issue isn't whether or not we make judgments, but whether or not we make the right judgments. Wow, okay, so that's a lot to swallow. A lot of great information, but I love how he really just broke down going into tolerance and what this new definition our culture has made it, which is super interesting. So a few things to wrap up the summary are, number one, despite the relativism that emanates from our culture, truth is absolute, exclusive, and knowable. To deny absolute truth and its knowability is self-defeating. Number two, truth is not dependent on our feelings or preferences. Something is true whether we like it or not. And then number three, contrary to popular opinion, major world religions do not all teach the same thing. They have essential differences and only superficial agreements. All religions cannot be true because they teach opposites. And I love what the authors said at the very end in the last chapter, in the last paragraph of this chapter. They basically said, since logically all religions cannot be true, we cannot subscribe to the new definition of tolerance that demands that we accept the impossible idea that all religious beliefs are true. We are to respect the beliefs of others, but lovingly share the truth. After all, if your doctor loves you and you had a serious health issue, they would lovingly tell you the truth. So anyways, a lot of great information. I hope you got one great piece of valuable information out of this. Again, super interesting book. I just wanted to walk through with you guys. So that was my quick video summary of the book, I Do Not Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. So anyways, God bless you guys. Thank you so much for watching this, and have an amazing COVID-19 style July 4th, 2020. Talk to you soon. Bye.